Yeah, so, yeah, in line with bringing to you who is who in speech and hearing science and language, human language technology, we brought today Dr. Malcolm Slaney, who is one of the giants of the field, I would say. Well, he, not only that he's big, but he also is very influential. I remember him in the early 80s. He showed up, started working on auditory models. Now, if you go on the web, you will find all kinds of software donated from Malcolm, because he claims that every major corporation is supposed to support basic research at least for 2 years. So in line with that, he goes from corporation to corporation and they support his basic research. So if I remember correctly, you started with Schlumberger, right? Schlumberger,
Apple.
Xerox, Apple. IBM,
Interval.
Now I believe it's still Yahoo, right? Yeah. It's still Yahoo. So there's the corporations keep changing, but what stays is Malcolm's devotion to hearing science. He also runs highly acclaimed series of the talks at Stanford University in the Center for Music and Research
for music and
Acoustics. It's going on for 20 years or something like that. So he definitely is one of those people who are out there and are very influential. We are very happy to have him here. And please, Malcolm Slaney, here he is. He's yours.
Thank you, Henrik.
Press the help button.
We got it working finally.
Oh, you got it working?
Yeah, we had to power it off and back on again.
Oh, okay. Sorry about that.
Thank you. It's nice to be here. I think my body says it's about 6 o'clock in the morning. Hopefully I'll be coherent, but either way you should ask me questions, because I much prefer to make this a discussion. I don't know your background. Mooji suggested I talk about some stuff I talked about here at Johns Hopkins a few months ago. Sort of a basic introduction to some of the problems I think are important in the way speech is perceived. I should start this off by saying that I was trained as a double E and thought about things like speech recognition, and then sort of became interested in the auditory perception part later. And so I tend to harp on aspects of the problem that I think are important. And one of those aspects you'll hear about in a few minutes is this idea of, you know, how do you use FFTs? Are FFTs a good model? And the short answer is FFTs are not a good model, but they're a good implementation. And we'll talk a little bit about that in a few minutes. So this is the outline of the talk. it's basically four sections, not exactly shown this way, talking about our nonlinear cochlea and how that affects auditory models. I would spend a lot of time talking about pitch and how to think about pitch and how to work with pitch, which I think is an important aspect of the really hard problem in speech recognition, which is how do you do the cocktail party effect? How do you separate speech out from its background? And I think that's really the big unsolved problem in speech. And hopefully I can give you guys some ideas on what I think is important about that. I'm also working with a student at Stanford, Greg Sell. And he's been doing some very nice work on modulation and demodulation. And I want to inflict upon you guys the first version of this work. So this is definitely work in progress. I think we have some answers, but we also have lots of questions. And I'd like to try this stuff out on you and see what you guys think. And because I suspect all of you have thought a lot about speech, and hopefully you've thought a lot about filtering and modulation. And if there's time, I'll say a little bit about the auditory scene analysis problem and how the auditory system might address that. But I think as speech recognition people, you guys already believe in top-down models and understand the importance of language models and stuff like that. It's new for auditory people. It's old hat for speech people. Or speech recognition people. So I'm going to say a few words about that at the end. A large part of my perspective on hearing is sort of summarized or is motivated by this graph, which comes from Petuzzi and Yates in 1986 in guinea pigs. These are measurements of real cochlear motion. So the cochlea is what perceive sound and converts it into nerve cells. And it's a mechanical device has some very wonderful properties. And there's hair cells attached to that, which I'll talk about in a few minutes, that actually sense the movement and then turn that into nerve firings that go up the cortex. But there's a lot of magic here, and I think it's important to start with this because you need to understand what's going on in the system in order to build models of it and work with it. And the most important thing to see in this model is that it's nonlinear. If you look at the graph on the left, on the horizontal axis you're seeing frequency, and on the vertical axis you're seeing mechanical motion. And this is for one particular position on the basilar membrane. In this time and age, it was done with a radioactive source. So they put a little radioactive source on the basilar membrane in one location. They put sounds into the ear, and then they can measure how much that source is moving by Doppler shift. So it's a very hard experiment to do, but they can get very good data from it. And if you look on the left-hand side, you'll see that there's, one, two, three, four curves at different amplitudes. So the bottom curve is for 20 dB sound, just barely a whisper. And then 40 dB above that, 60 and 80 dB. And what you see is on the left-hand side, as the amplitude of the sound goes up by 20 dB, the motion of the basilar membrane goes up by 20 dB. So that's, a nice linear system on the left-hand side. But it's much more interesting on the right-hand side, and that's where all the action is. So if you see the curve on the right, the bottom curve, is very narrow. And as the amplitude goes up by 20 dB, here at the most sensitive portion, it only goes up maybe 5 dB in motion. And the reason this is the most sensitive is that this is for a constant level of sound. And at 14 or 17 dB, or 17 kilohertz, this portion of the basilar membrane is responding better than any other frequency. So that's the best frequency, the characteristic frequency of this position on the cochlea. And as you increase the level, you don't get quite as much gain. So there's lots of discussions about what this means. The important thing, I think, for people who think about speech in the auditory system is that the system's nonlinear. You're adding energy to the system, but it's not coming out in the same way. There's a big debate among auditory people about whether this is an active amplifier or whether it's just a nonlinear system. My personal view, I don't work on this area myself, so I'm not an authority, but my view of the literature is that it's got to be an active amplifier. It's got to be something putting energy into the system and causing this peak to be so tall. But there's people like John Allen who believe that the behavior can be modeled by just a system that has a changing impedance, and that would account for the difference. But this is a surprisingly sensitive system. I mean, these are really tiny motions, and the system's amplifying them, I believe, so that it can hear them. And if the animal dies, then all these curves flatten out. So this curve will come down here, and there'll be 20 dB separation everywhere. So this behavior is only true in a living animal. When you guys are listening to me, this is what your tuning curves are looking like. So it's really a pretty amazing system, and I think it's important to keep track of the nonlinearities. I mentioned that I wanted to talk about the hair cells. The hair cells are pretty amazing because they're what transduce sound, and they're also implicated in the game system, the application system. This is a 10, 15 years ago, I guess, people were starting to make these recordings. This is a hair cell that's been excised, and it's sitting in a petri dish, and there's a pipette going into it that they can put charge into it. And then you can't see them very well in the static video. I don't know if you can see them in the video on the screen, but there's some little hair cells that actually are sitting in the fluid and sense the motion. And this video shows how the hair cell can change its shape or change its size based on electrical stimulation. And they've measured these hair cells changing size at frequencies up to 15 kilohertz. So it makes them the fastest moving body part around. So it's really pretty cool.
2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock. 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, rock. We're going to rock. Around.
You can't see the cilia. But you should see this thing pushing up and down, and you should see this expanding a little bit. So it's really pretty cool that this little cell can respond so well and so fast and over so many decades of life, and it works pretty well. And if you play too much of it, then the hair cells die off, and that's what causes hard of hearing. If you listen too much Billy Haley, that's what happens. So this is the first step of the neural pathway. And this is a simulation, I'll show you real data in a second, of the information that's encoded on the auditory nerve. So this is everything you have. You're listening to me, this is what you're seeing, this is what the brain gets. That's everything there is. And there's a lot of information here. It's not just LPC coefficients or MFCC. There's a lot more stuff here. And I'd like to walk you through what's here. On the vertical axis, this is just like a spectrogram. On the vertical axis, you have frequency. On the horizontal axis, you have time. And we've blown it up a lot. So what you're seeing here in these vertical slices are the glottal pulses coming in. You're hearing each individual puff of air. And so they're marked with the arrows there. So this is probably 150 hertz. So this would be what? Can't do the math in my head. 60 milliseconds? Between glottal pulses. And so you're seeing, the cochlea starts the high frequency side. So you see the firings from the high frequency auditory nerves first. And then you see a little slope here. And then things slow down. You can see the formants here and here and maybe here. Actually, I think it's here. There's two here that are close. And then there's something else going on here. And what else can I show you there? Oh, you're seeing individual cycles of the harmonics. So you're seeing all these little harmonics showing up at different times. So this is what it looks like in real life. My friend Shihab Sharma did this plot, and I can spend a whole hour on just this one plot because there's an amazing amount of stuff here. He did this by taking, it's Johns Hopkins data from Sachs and Young, and reformatting it and replotting it, and got a nice paper out of it. And this figure actually goes for three or four pages in the paper. What else? Let's see. Oh, it's turned upside down, so that's one difference. So you're seeing it going this way more. You can see. Let's see. Where do I start? You can see so first of all, you can see the glottal pulses, as I showed you before. This is for cat data, and the cat was listening to a single vowel. I forget which one it was. One of the things I think is interesting from this is that it's kind of hard to see in this display, but you can see the different formants. They're marked out here on the side, F1, F2, and F3. So there's going to be more energy, more firing here. But another thing that you see is that the hair cells are locking to individual harmonics. And if this is a better quality reproduction, you can actually see the different harmonics. 2, 3, I can't read the numbers on the side here. But the individual harmonics are marked here. And if you look at the spacing of the peaks, if you look at the firing times, you can actually count out the different harmonics. And you'll see that different portions of the auditory bundle will respond to different harmonics. So every harmonics can be represented, and you'll see a patch of harmonics, a patch of fibers that are all responding to the eighth harmonic. And then you go a little bit farther, and then they all start responding to the seventh harmonic. And that's another nonlinearity in the auditory system, because the detector is very, very nonlinear. The hair cell is responding to the most important frequencies. It's going to respond and synchronize to the most important frequencies that it sees. And what it sees are a bunch of harmonics, and it's going to pick the one that's at the center of its range. And that'll be the one that gets the most response. So there's just a wonderful amount of detail here. And now the problem is, how do you make sense of it all? So speech people, speech recognition people, for a long time, and it's a great solution, have used things like MFCC and LPC to take this incredible richness of data and translate it down to 13 numbers. So
actually, this is 50 milliseconds. So this is only a third of a speech frame.
And a speech recognizer will see this as 13 numbers, which is, I mean, it's a great solution. I'm not saying it's a bad solution. It works really well. But there's a lot of stuff that's getting thrown away. And now the question is, how do we make use of that? And I think the most important thing, as I said before, is there's a lot of information here that lets us do the cocktail party effect. And that's, I think, going to be where the fun is. So for a long time, I've been suggesting a representation known as a corellogram as a way of making sense of all this. We've done a lot of work on this as a model of pitch. But I think, and there's a lot of debate about whether this is a reasonable psychophysical model or perceptual model of pitch. But I think it's a useful way of thinking about sound and talking about the cocktail party effect. So regardless of whether it's a perceptually valid thing, I think it is, it's still an interesting way of looking at sound. And I want to talk about a bunch of examples using the corellogram as a visualization technique. And the idea is that you have a cochlea with hair cells. And so the data I've shown you before were different, you know, slices of data along this axis here. And what we do to make sense of it all is put it into an autocorrelation structure, which tries to capture the periodicity in the sound. So if you recall, in this figure, there's a lot of periodicity at every glottal pulse. There's a lot of common information from pulse to pulse, from speech epoch to speech epoch. And capturing that, I think, is a useful thing to do. Roy Patterson, who works on the similar problem, likes to talk about in terms of stabilizing the display. So if you look at this, it goes flowing by in time. And what Roy Patterson wanted to do was stabilize it and make a static picture. He does it one way. I deal with correlation. And what comes out is a picture. So this is an example of the representation. Essentially, all we've done is we've taken this data that's flowing by and captured it so it's on top of each other. If you give it a tone, that's on the top, the corellogram is what's shown here. And there's a couple things to see. First of all, the sound comes in the top, high frequency first, and propagates down the cochlea. And it's basically very, very dim here. And then eventually grows, and you get a good response. So this is the characteristic frequency, the best frequency for this, what's responding best to this tone. And then it gets cut off, because that's the way the cochlea works. Is it propagates the wave, it amplifies it, and then cuts it off. So you're seeing this basic mechanical property here. And then you're seeing it's 200 hertz, five millisecond periodicity in the sound. And so this is a very static thing, and there's not much going on. If you add harmonics to it, though, so this is 200, 400, 600, 800, then you start to see the same bottom part. But then you see at 400 hertz, you see a 2.5 millisecond periodicity. And then so on going up. And so here you're seeing the first eight harmonics. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 maybe. And hopefully 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah, 8 going this way. So that's the basic representation.
Question.
Yeah.
Is there any type of adaptation that happens with
the... Absolutely. There's a lot of adaptation, but mostly because these displays can only give you 8-bit dynamic range, and the auditory system's, you know, 80 dB of dynamic range. And so the auditory model I used was done by Dick Lyon many years ago. And one of the things that's in that model, which is still, I don't know if Laurel Carney's model has it or not, but it has a large number of adaptation constants built into it, from very short-term things that would represent the feedback that goes on in the inner hair cell, outer hair cell loop, all the way to things that go through cortex and out to the middle ear. And so doing dynamic range control is really important in these kind of displays, because the level of sound is varying so much, and these displays can't do that. speech recognition does that by, you know, pulling C0 out as a separate coefficient and you know, dealing with it on its own. But for these display, yeah, there's a lot of adaptation going on. Does that answer your question? So this is an example that Dick Duda, as in Duda and Hart did, Duda Hart and Stork now, I guess, showing some examples. I think it's kind of fun to talk about what they mean. The axes are labeled. Let me go ahead and play it. Hopefully the technology works. Tone. All the harmonics. One at a time. Fast. Backwards, I think. Missing fundamental. Enough for fun. So this is a cocktail party effect. So this is, I mean, this is the simplest possible cocktail party. And we can't, I mean, I guess we can solve this one, but we can't do much more than this. And the reason this is an interesting problem is because you're hearing the static sound, you're hearing the drone, and then one of the harmonics starts moving, and it pops out instantaneously. I mean, you can't help but listen to this new sound that showed up out of nowhere. And as soon as it stops moving, it sort of blends back into the background. And I mean, if you really listened, you could hear it out, but it'd be very difficult to hear it out for very long. And so we'd like to be able to understand how to model that and how to pick that out. Because it happens in real life. I mean, it happens in regular environments. You know, you hear my voice, you hear it differently from the fan noises up there, and you have no problem picking my voice out. And I'd like to know how to do that. This is some speech examples. If it's unvoiced, like an S, there's just no periodicity. You just get this blob of energy across the top. And if it's a vowel, as you'd expect, you get some formants, and you see the pitch interval. This is actually a very, very old animation I did, one of the first ones I did. And it's kind of fun because, well, it's cheesy because this was when I was at Apple and we were doing this presentation for the execs, and we got an opera singer to play Leonardo da Vinci exploring a bunch of technology. So this is Leonardo da Vinci explaining the parallelogram. So that's the cheesy part. The good part is he sings much better than I do. So that's why I keep using it. Oops. Okay. Oh God, you might have to listen to me sing. I don't know why this is not working here. Let me try one thing. I don't understand. Well, I apologize for that part. Hopefully the rest works okay. The main thing, I can show you a different way, but the main thing this shows you is that it's a very dynamic display. It's very hard to read it. Victor Zhu liked to read spectrograms, but I think you have a very hard time reading this because it goes by so fast. And the main thing I wanted to show you, and I'll show you in a second live, is that you see formants move and you see the pitch change. So the pitch is going to show up as a vertical bar at different places, and the formants will change. And we have a simulation of this. Okay, hopefully this works. E, ah, ooh. So Leonardo da Vinci does it much better than I do, but hopefully you get a sense of what's going on. This is with the adaptation model we talked about before. And that's important because my speech here is varying over 20, 30, 40 dB as I start and stop speaking, and you get different sounds. And you can see the pitch changing, and you can see the formants changing. And we think our claim is that this still has all the information in the speech signal. And the reason we claim this is that we can take this representation and invert it and come up with something that sounds nearly identical to the original sound. So you can do the same thing with speech, and I'm sorry, you could do the same thing with MFCC, but you'd lose the pitch information, and you'd lose a lot of other details because you only have 13 coefficients. But we can take this and go back to speech, and we get something that sounds pretty close to the original. We think within the bounds of signal processing errors. There's a lot of signal processing going on here. So we believe that nothing's been lost from the signal. But then we haven't actually proved that we can do the cocktail party effect with this yet either. So it's still an open question. But anyway, that's what the coelogram is. And after 20 years, it's nice to have a real-time version. So the obvious thing to do with this, and the simplest low-hanging fruit, as we like to put it, was to use it as a a means of extracting pitch. And so this is some work that I did with Dick Lyon, who's now at Google. We thought this would be a really easy paper to write for ICAST. It's just incredibly obvious that this is where the pitch is. I mean, that's how you perceive it. I should also point out that there's a big discussion about what pitch really means. And pitch means different things to different people. I come from psychoacoustics, and I believe that pitch is what people hear. And if you look at the standard says that pitch is that attribute of sound that lets you put it into a melody or to order sounds into a melody. And so that's definitely a perceptual thing. You can hear a musical melody out of all this stuff. Linguists and basic speech people believe that pitch is whatever the glottis is doing. And so the glottis is going at 200 hertz, then that's what the pitch is. And that's a reasonable model for most speech, but then things get complicated when you start getting creaky voice and things like that. And there's a whole bunch of things that have a pitch that aren't coming from a glottis. And so that's why I think the perceptual aspect is more important. And if you're coming from the engineering world, which is where I came from, then you believe pitch is whatever the peak of the Fourier transformers or whatever the spacing of harmonics are. So F0 is the pitch. And it turns out that that's not a very good model for pitch because there's a lot of sounds that are inharmonic that have a pitch. Or you can have sounds that are basically noise and you can hear a pitch. And so actually building models that implement or that model human pitch perception is a challenging problem. But I think the coelogram does a very good job of it. And there's still a lot of discussion about whether it's being done with temporal cues, like I'm talking about here, or just looking at frequency cues. But I think this is sort of the state of the art in temporal pitch perception models. This is the architecture of what I just showed you. You have a cochlear model. This is what's showing up on the hair cells, the auditory bundle. In my case, it's 85 channels. The autocorrelation, the coelogram that I showed you. And so you get a number of different the original 85 channels plus 1,000 time samples. And then you just look for the peak in this. And I should point out that there's it's important to be mindful of the fact that there's a model, which we believe is that temporal periodicity is important and that the auditory system does perceive periodicity in the signal. And that's the model. And the implementation is done with FFTs. So some people think that the auditory system can be modeled as a Fourier analysis system. And you're right. In the broadest sense of the word, it is a spectral analysis. It is a Fourier transform. But there's so much other stuff going on, I think that's a really lousy model. And so I like to, actually I don't have the slide in here.
Dick Lyon likes to point out that George von Bekesy, who was one of the gods, original gods of hearing, said that dead cats and Fourier transforms have done more to harm hearing than anything else. So dead cats, because the original work on hearing was done with dead cats, because they're a lot easier to work with than live cats. but the problem with dead cats is that they don't have a cochlear amplifier. They don't have the nonlinear linearity in the system. So if you put sound into a dead cochlea, it looks like a Fourier transform. There's just nothing else. It's just, you know, sound goes in, you know, motion comes out. There's nothing interesting going on. So that's why dead cats are bad. And Fourier transforms are bad, because if you believe that the cochlea is linear, then obviously Fourier transforms are the way to go. I mean, they're a really efficient way of doing things. And so everybody assumes that, you know, Fourier transforms model the auditory system, and that's a bad model. So it's important to keep track of this, of the difference between a model and the implementation. And David Marr, who did a lot of work in computer vision, I thought pointed this out really well in his book published just after he died. There's a model. In this case, you know, the auditory system keeps track of periodicity and measures it and perceives it and represents it some way. And there's an implementation, which in this case is done with Fourier transforms, because Fourier transforms compute correlation very, very efficiently. But we're not arguing that the brain implements this model using Fourier transforms. But that should be obvious, I hope. Anyway, and then the pitch comes out at the far right here. This is an example from the auditory CD analysis, or no, I'm sorry, the auditory demonstration CD. And if you're interested in this, I really recommend this CD from the Acoustical Society. And it shows the perception of pitch in a simple cocktail party effect where they've added noise. And so this is the Westminster Chimes example. And they play it with both pure tone, and then they play it with the three harmonics above it. So there's missing fundamental. There's no energy at the fundamental. And they're going to alternate them. And they're going to show what happens when you add noise to this. And hopefully that works. Yeah.
Masking spectral and virtual pitch. You will hear the familiar Westminster chime melody played with pairs of tones. The first tone of each pair is a sinusoid. The second, a complex tone of the same pitch.
So just a tone in the harmonics. The lines are in the same spot. Can't do it fast enough. So the low and the high have the same pitch. And now he'll add noise.
Now the pure tone notes are masked with low pass noise. You will still hear the pitches of the complex tone.
So you can't hear the low pitch anymore. But you still can perceive it.
Finally, the complex tone is masked by high pass noise. The pure tone melody is still heard.
So I'm going to do this one real quick, because I want to move on to some other stuff. But this is kind of fun, because it demonstrates that pitch is very ambiguous. So actually, I forget which way this goes.
Circularity in pitch judgment. Two examples of scales that illustrate circularity in pitch judgment are presented. The first is a discrete scale of Roger N. Shepard. The second is a continuous scale of Jean-Claude Visset.
So how many people hear the pitch going up? Raise your hand, lower your hand if you hear it go down. Still going up? Still going up? Still going up? Still going up? So the reason for this is that the pitch is ambiguous, and what you're seeing on the right-hand side there
is that there's a couple different pitches that are possible, and you're following one. This is the curve is actually for the one on the right. The curve on the right is actually this one. And the reason that it's ambiguous is that you tend to follow one pitch for a while. I mean, pitches don't bob up and down by an octave on their own very often, except for creaky speech. And so you tend to follow one pitch line for a while, and then eventually your attention gets disturbed, or you forget what you're doing, and you say, oh, that pitch doesn't make any sense anymore. Here's a better pitch to follow. And so your auditory system sort of resets itself to a different pitch. And I haven't seen this, but I've heard that there's choruses that can do this effect. So that'd be kind of fun to see a chorus do this. This is the a summary of the two different approaches to pitch perception. On the left, we talked about the parallelogram already. And what comes out is this two-dimensional representation of sound versus time. There's a second approach, which is based on looking for the peaks in the spectrum in various forms. I think this is actually a Shihab slide, isn't it? I don't remember. I think this came from this might have been a Shihab one. Looking at and periodicity. I think he's actually looking at this. Wouldn't be periodicities. This is looking at spectrum. So looking at spectrum and trying to figure out which harmonics are present, and then from the harmonics, figuring out the pitch. And I think this works well in a single sound. I think it fails miserably in a complicated environment. And so, I don't want to try to sell you on the pattern matching or the place model of pitch, because I can't do it very well. But in my opinion, it doesn't make sense to do pitch perception this way, because our auditory environment is so complicated that there's so little information available on these spectral profiles. And at high amplitude sound, like in a normal sound, the rate profile is pretty flat. There's really not a lot of information at different firing rates. So I really think you have to use the temporal information to pull this out. But this is a source of major fights all over the world on how pitch is perceived. So you shouldn't take my word for it alone. But there's lots of different ways of implementing the parallelogram. The ones you saw today were all implemented with an FFT. Licklider, who proposed this in the 50s, suggested a neural delay line, which they've seen evidence for in bats. Roy Patterson's been doing this with a strobe temporal integration idea, where you actually look for pitch epochs and sort of grab the waveform at that point. And there's a bunch of people looking at things like oscillators and AM modulation as a way of implementing this. Jonathan from South Africa, can't think of his last name. Tapson, thank you. Has been looking at spike latencies as a way of implementing this kind of calculation. And so I think that's promising. And just to summarize this little bit of it, this is the processing chain. Actually, I don't know what happened to my waveform, but you guys know what a waveform looks like. This is what a spectrogram is. This is actually a cochlogram, so it's been adjusted so that it has the same spacing as a cochlea would. And I assume all you guys know about MFCCs. This is basically the representation, the 40-dimensional representation that MFCC starts with before they do the DCT. And then the parallelogram at the bottom. Do you have any questions about the pitch stuff or the representation before I move on to the next topic? So this is new material. This is work in progress. We think we have a good answer. This is mostly my student's work, Greg Sell. And I think it's relevant because for a couple reasons. One, there's been a bunch of interest lately in the fine time structure in speech. And it's come up as a possible way of, well, I'll talk about applications in a second. Anyway, this modulation is interesting, and I want to talk a little bit about what it meant and think about what it means for the for a speech signal. And I think all you guys have much more experience with speech than I do, and so I'm hoping we can have a discussion about this. We started with a very simple problem of what is modulation and how do you modulate it? And the problem with I mean, modulation is what's shown here in the top. The modulation times a carrier gives you a signal. And when we want to do demodulation, we start with a signal, we have S, and we want to figure out what M and C are. We want to figure out the modulator, we want to figure out the carrier. And there's an example of this shown, of the modulation process shown here. So we have this modulation of some sort, an amplitude gain. We have a fixed carrier, and you're seeing a little bit of variation at the top because of sampling the sine wave, but this is just a sine wave. Multiply the two together, you get that. Demodulation has been interesting, and I think it's becoming more interesting right now for a number of reasons. People have been spending a lot of time on the research side looking at modulation as a way of encoding information for cochlear implants, where they actually insert electrodes into the cochlea and excite the system that way. And this has led to some work on chimeric speech, where they take the fine time structure from one signal and they take the envelope from another signal and put them together and try to measure how much information is in the fine time signal. And so there's been a lot of work on that using a particular form of demodulation that I'll talk about a little bit later, which we think is flawed. We hope we have a better solution. And it's also been used for speech enhancement. By enhancing the modulation or reducing the modulation, you can affect the intelligibility, hopefully in a positive way. And hopefully it'll lead to some work and some good things on source separation, which I think Munya has done better than anybody else. And we've been motivated by the work that Les Atlas has been doing at University of Washington, and also Oda Gitsa, who, I don't remember where he's working now, on this idea of modulation filtering. So all of you are used to frequency filtering. You know, you have a frequency, you have a signal, you want to filter out everything above 3 kilohertz. You know what that means. Well, Les Atlas has been talking about the idea of modulation filtering. So you want to remove everything that's modulation above 10 hertz or something like that. And that's along the lines of what Brian Kingsbury has been doing for a long time. The chimeric speech is interesting, and this is a schematic of it from the original paper. And I forget the first author. Bertrand Delgoud is the one I know who did this. But he's not the first author. So you have a sound coming in, the green and the magenta, I guess, purple. And we'll talk about the Hilbert transform in a second, what that means. But what you get out from this process is something that has the envelope and something that has a fine time structure. And you do this on two different signals. And then what they want to do is they want to take the envelope from one signal and the fine time structure from another signal and put them together. And they're doing this because the envelope is what's often used in a cochlear implant. And so they're trying to understand what works for patients who need cochlear implants. But the more important thing they're trying to do is understand the effect of fine time structure. So they want to understand what information is present in this part of the signal. And what do people perceive? So this is a, yeah.
Sorry, on the previous slide, I'm not sure I understand why modulation, I mean, I don't understand what modulation is the model here.
Let me come back to that. I think I need to move this slide up earlier, but I've got it. Well, let me. Okay, where is it? It's actually quite a ways in. Let me come back to that. Let's just talk about the basic math problem first, and then I'll come back to the speech problem. So the basic math problem is what's shown on this slide. You're given S, and now you want to figure out M and C. And the problem is that it's inherently ambiguous. And as we say at the bottom, For any M, there's a valid C. You just divide it. It's no big deal. So you can essentially, you can choose a different speech signal for the modulation, and you'll still get a carrier that makes sense. I mean, you'll still get a carrier. So mathematically, as long as you don't divide by zero, then you can do this decomposition. There's an infinite number of possibilities, and that's not necessarily a very good answer. This makes it more real. If you have a signal S that here is composed of a product of three cosine waveforms, 2, 10, and 100, you can demodulate this either as a 2 hertz modulation and this more complicated carrier, or you can just demodulate it as a 100 hertz carrier and this more simple and this more complicated modulation system product. And both of these are perfectly valid. And so then the question is, which one do you want? And how do you do this decomposition? And there's also a perceptual aspect to all this, because depending on the modulation rate, you can get different answers. So here's an example where we've added 8.7 hertz modulation, and you can hear this as an AM flutter. You can sort of hear this as a ripple or a flutter. I'm not sure what you'd call it. But it's very perceptible. But if you increase the modulation to 250 hertz, so it's got exactly the same carrier, but all we've done is change it to a 250 hertz, then you get something that sounds like a musical note. You know, it has a very musical quality to it, has a pitch to it. And so, in a sense, this thing, which has the pitch of this will be whatever the carrier is, but if you modulate with 250 hertz, the pitch changes down to, you know, something with a 250 hertz modulation. And the teaser is that, so what Greg has been doing for his PhD work is building new ways of demodulating things. And so he's got a log and a linear that I'll talk about a little bit that both demodulate this in the way that we want to do. So the goals of this work are to be able to formulate solutions that we want and specify what we do want. And that means we have to have the flexibility to define what the right solution is. And so that means, in our case, we want the lower frequency signal to be the modulation, and we want the higher frequency information to be the carrier. So that's all easy. And I think the part that's new is we want to be able to make this work for harmonic and noisy carriers. So I think the stuff that we've done that's new in this problem is that part. And there's something known as a projection property, which basically says that we want the decomposition to be complete. So if you take a signal and you demodulate it, you get a result. That's great. If you demodulate those things again, nothing changes. You've got all the modulation out. And so that's what we mean by the projection property. And this builds upon a bunch of work that's been done by a number of different people. I'll talk about all these in more detail in a second. The Hilbert, the halfway Fulbright magnifier, Steven Greenberg and Brian Kingsbury, who both I think have been part of this workshop.
Right.
Actually, some of the work was done. This work was done at ICSI. Maybe it was done here too. So on modulation spectrogram, which has a lot of, I'll talk about that in a little bit. Mooney's work on a cortical representation, and the work that's been coming out of University of Washington on subbands, where you actually take bands of sound, as in from a cochlear filter bank, and demodulate within that. So the Hilbert envelope is the easiest and most common way of demodulating things, and it's also the basis of the work that's been done on chimeric speech. And the idea is that you take a sound or take a signal and put it through a Hilbert transform, which essentially rotates the phase of the signal by 90 degrees. So if you put in a cosine, a sine comes out. I'm ignoring the sines, but you know it shifts it by 90 degrees. And if you put in what comes out, and that's the analytic signal, S tilde here. And if you take the magnitude of that, so this is S tilde is going to be complex. If you take the magnitude of that, you're left with the envelope. You remove the underlying carrier. And it's a very nice and simple model. The good part is easy. The bad part, and I'll talk about all these different things, is it doesn't handle negative modulation. So if the modulation goes below zero, so you're going to turn things around, it can't handle that. And it assumes that the modulation is band limited, which is really hard to do because, you know, the real world is not band limited, or at least not theoretically band limited. And something else it can't do is it doesn't handle harmonic or noisy carriers. So if you have a complicated sound with multiple carriers or with noise as a carrier, then the Hilbert transform doesn't give an answer that makes sense. And it's furthermore got a hardwired definition of modulation. So the ambiguity I showed you before, where you have the pitch or the amplitude modulation, isn't dealt with by a Hilbert transform because it only has one definition of what the carrier is. So the three graphs along the bottom show what happens if you have, you can't read the axis. So this is 100% modulation from 0 to 1. If he actually goes negative, so you have, it's called suppressed carrier in communications terms, the Hilbert transform just recovers the absolute value of the envelope. And then if you have a harmonic signal, then it gets confused. Although if you filter out the high frequency stuff, you get something that's a pretty good representation. Half wave and full wave rectifiers are another way to do it. And cheap AIM radios actually did this for a long time. So I actually don't know if they do it this way anymore. They might. So you can demodulate just by using a half-wave rectifier and then a low-pass filter, and that's what's shown here. Here's the signal. You rectify it. You just get the positive part. You low-pass filter, and then you're left with the envelope. And that works reasonably well. Steve Greenberg and Brian Kingsbury spent a lot of time looking at the modulation spectrogram, and that became the focus of Brian's PhD work at Berkeley, I think. And it's a very simple model where you do the cochlear like decomposition. So you have a bunch of channel filters. You do a half-wave rectifier, and that detects the energy in a signal. You downsample it, and then you compute the Fourier transform of that signal, and that gives you a modulation spectrogram. And their primary contribution was to note that for speech signals, most of the information was in a band of modulation frequencies between 0 and 8 hertz, basically centered at 4 hertz. So their observation was that modulation at 4 hertz was where most of the speech information was. And so they're showing here, if you add noise to a signal, in this case a wideband noise,
I don't remember what that bottom right figure is.
Anyway, the main point is what's shown on the left, which is that the modulation spectrogram is very robust to additions of noise and stuff, and so you can still see the speech signal if you do this modulation filtering first. And the things that it doesn't work is that it first requires a subband decomposition, and I'll talk about what that means in a bit and why that's a problem. And it has the same drawbacks as half-wave rectifier because you can't handle wideband sounds and things like that. Shihab and his colleagues at Maryland have been spending a lot of time thinking about a biologically inspired model of perception based on ripples. And I'm sure someone here is going to talk about it better than I can, so I'm not going to try today. We're still trying to figure out how this all fits together. It's very closely related, but it's primarily motivated by the biology, and so I'm not sure quite how to describe in terms of the mathematics and signal processing and how it fits together. And so I'm not going to really talk about that today. But I do want to talk about the issues of subband carrier demodulation because it's kind of important for thinking about speech signals. The basic issue is that you have these channel filters that we talked about before, and from that, either with the analytic signal or the regular signal, then you want to do a carrier estimation on that. You want to figure out what's going on in the signal. And the reason, this has been largely promoted by the University of Washington people, because the problem with regular modulation detection is that it doesn't handle multiple harmonics very well. And speech has multiple harmonics. You know, it's really hard. I mean, sine wave speech doesn't have harmonics, but any interesting speech signal has harmonics. And it's hard to do demodulation with multiple harmonics. And so the obvious answer is, well, you do decomposition, you do subbands. So you take each individual cochlear channel and do demodulation within that. And that's what's going on here. So the good news is it guarantees that the modulation is band limited. The not so good thing is that speech in a subband is not a very pretty signal. And the reason why is if your subbands are too big, then you have multiple harmonics. And so then you're back to the original problem. More importantly, if you only have one harmonic, if it's not centered in the band, then you can have some weird effects on the sidebands. So if it's modulated, you have the original information plus you have some sidebands, and that's how you detect the modulation. But if your signal isn't centered in the subband, then some of the sidebands are going to be filtered differently than the other ones. So you don't have a symmetric relationship anymore. And so the signal gets very hard to compute. And their answer is, well, we'll just use a complex modulator. So the Washington people say, well, if we model it as a complex modulator, then we get the right answer. And they're right, it is the right answer mathematically, but then it's not clear to me what a complex modulator means for speech. And so we don't think that's a good solution.
So I feel like what you're trying to say is that in the speech signal, or in the noise signal, you're going to have bands on which, you know, temporally the speech is right? But, and so if you're modeling it like this, you kind of have to, like, pick channels ahead of time, which is kind of annoying. But, I mean, I feel like the brain can be kind of adaptive. It kind of knows where, you know, what speech sounds like. Right. So
clearly,
in some sense, you can imagine a system where, you know, you're trying to figure out what arrangement of channels is really.
So that's a great answer, great question, and great answer. But the problem is that the channels in the auditory system are fixed by the mechanics of the basal membrane. And so if you go back to that original figure I showed you before with the tuning curve, it went from very, very narrow to very wide. What I didn't talk about is how that center frequency shifts from 17 kilohertz down to 14 kilohertz. And so not only are they fixed, but they're also changing based on level. And so the channels are really kind of nasty in the auditory system. So we like to think about them in terms of an FFT bin, but the auditory system isn't that nice. Two slides, and I want to talk about the speech information. Let me skip this. I've already talked about this. There's a lot of issues with subbands, and we're really trying to find a better way, because lots of people are using them. And one of the problems is that it's very hard to resynthesize the original speech. And so what you're seeing here is a chirp. And I forget what it looks like from 100 hertz to 2 kilohertz. We need to redo this figure. The slight variations you're seeing, the little ripple here and the background noise, is coming from phase effects of the sampling. So these are really low-level effects. But this is essentially just a single chirp with a little bit of noise because of digital sampling. And the problem with subbands is if you want to detect the modulator, you can do that, but then if you want to put it back together again, you get all these weird artifacts as the chirp passes from subband to subband. And so you're seeing that here. Okay, this is the slide I was looking for earlier. And this is bringing it back to speech. Speech is a complicated signal. And it's especially complicated if you break it apart into its different components and try to model it as a signal processing system. And in this decomposition, we're arguing that the speech signal is actually three different kinds of modulation and two different kinds of filtering. And that makes it very hard to decompose all that, because we're having a hard time just decomposing one modulation. And now we're saying it's three modulations and two filterings. And it's hard to interpret what's going where. So the first modulation is just how much pressure is my body, the diaphragm, putting into the lungs, forcing air out. So that is the diaphragm, which is forcing, is a form of modulation. The vocal cords, open and closing, represent the glottal pulses of sound or speech. And so that's another kind of modulation. And then the vocal tract is providing filtering. So the vocal tract is causing some harmonics to have more energy than other harmonics. And it's filtering the air as it comes through the vocal system. And then the mouth, open and closing, is a kind of modulation again. And then the lips, the sound coming out of the lips, is a horn-like thing, represents a kind of filtering. And so... Well, so that's the root of the problem. because you know, you can call this modulation and all this other stuff filtering if you want. I mean, you can split this up in multiple ways. And so this is sort of all the gory details. And what people try to do, what we try to do, is we try to model it as just one modulation system. So here's a vocal tract, and it's gonna you know, modify the speech in an interesting way. And it's gonna be driven by this glottal pulses. I mean, this is sort of the source filter model. And so that's a really simple decomposition of the signal. And we're arguing that that's not necessarily right. Because, there's really all this stuff going on. And the reason this is important is shown here, which is sort of the crux of the problem with demodulation of speech. Depending on how you decompose a signal, you get different answers. So if you take a speech signal, I mean, you guys have all looked at speech waveforms. And if you look at it multiple seconds, you'll see this waveform that goes up and down based on how much energy there is in the speech signal over several seconds. And so from a modulation point of view, the modulation is the overall amplitude envelope. And then the carrier is everything else below that, which in speech means the carrier is changing from harmonics to noise. And then to make it more interesting, the harmonic amplitudes are changing with time too. So from a pure mathematical point of view, the modulation is going to be picked out as just the overall envelope of the energy. If you start decomposing the sound into subbands, which is what's shown here, so this is in the middle is 11 channel cochlea, and the right-hand side is 101 channel cochlea, then you start seeing different things. And the primary effect is that you've remove the effect of different formant frequencies. You've sort of normalized frequency across channels. And so what's being shown here are the carriers. So there's a different modulation thing. And you can sort of see it here. So there's definitely, right about here, there's probably a formant here, and that's pretty high for a formant, but there's definitely more energy here. So I don't know which one of these are formants, but there's more energy here, less energy in the middle, and more energy here. And if you go to the same spot in the 11 subband case, then that formant information has been washed out. So the carrier is now these sinusoids, these harmonics that are all basically the same level now. And so then the modulation is going to be, how does this signal change over time at this one particular channel? And the question we have is this an issue of modulation or filtering? This is what we're trying to work on, this is what we're trying to understand. I'm not going to go through the solution, but I wanted to give you a flavor for it. What Greg and I have been working on is an optimization framework for demodulation. So before you saw signal processing solutions, now we're arguing that optimization is the right way of doing it. And what we want to do is minimize a cost function, which is a function of modulation and the carrier. So we have this loss function that we're going to try to minimize. And I'll tell you how we get these two functions in a second. Subject to two constraints. This is a convex optimization setup where you want a constraint on the modulation and the carrier to be less than or equal to zero, or you want it to be equal to zero. So there's two different ways of doing this thing. But the key work is in these loss functions. And this is a fairly easy problem. People do this kind of optimization all the time. Except for speech signals, depending on your sample rate, you might have 22,000 variables a second. So the optimization problem we're going to solve is we want to find M of T and C of T, where M of T represents 22,000 free parameters every second. And we can do this with convex optimization very efficiently. And so new computers and better convex optimization algorithms make this possible. So there's a couple of solutions, one based on a log domain representation and one based on a linear domain. We're working on the paper now. I'm not going to give you the details today. But I just wanted to give you a flavor for the kind of solutions that are possible. In the log case, we're going to the loss function is going to be is trying to smooth the second derivative of the modulation. And I have a star next to derivative because we can't actually can't actually measure the second derivative in the log domain. But we also want the carrier to be sparse. And in the linear domain, we want to minimize the high-frequency modulation energy. And so we can write these mathematically, plug these into a MATLAB solver, and come up with an answer fairly quickly. Here's some examples of speech that we've demodulated. And we get the right answer. I mean, these are kind of boring slides, but it's interesting to start plotting what this means. So this is a plot of the energy of the air in measuring the, I think it's the modulation, as we increase the modulation frequency. So this particular optimization setup had a cutoff around 37 hertz. And as the modulation increases from zero to 50 hertz or 60 hertz, the air starts picking up. So at some point here, the energy gets moved into the carrier instead of the modulation. We've done the same thing with harmonic carriers, and this works well, although you get different answers. A little bit of an error in the linear case here. And we can do the same thing with noise. And we're starting to look at what happens when you add noise to the signal. So you'll recall that the original formulation for the demodulation was S equals M times C. There's no plus N on the other side. So now in this case, we're actually adding noise, and we're measuring how the algorithms perform when noise is added. And in this case, the model does pretty well until we get to about 6 dB, which is basically here. And then below zero, it's starting to fall apart. So I think Greg was a bit pessimistic, saying it only went to about 6 dB. But we do pretty well down to zero, which I think is important. And again, more speech examples. And this is definitely a work in progress in the sense we're still trying to understand what modulation means in terms of speech and how to work with it. And I think we'll be spending a lot of time on that this summer. So I'm looking forward to that. And we'll have a better answer in the summer. I want to end with this. Maybe I'll do one example. But this is probably a good place to end. This is the processing chain that we've talked about on the right-hand side. Waveform comes in. The auditory nerve representation is shown on the middle of the right here. And this is still more information than what MFCC or LPC uses. And if we blow this up and look at the fine time structure, we get the parallelogram. I think that's where the interesting information is going to be for solving the cocktail party effect. I think that's going to be fun. What's shown on the left-hand side is a model that Lloyd Watts did based on a bunch of different work from all over the world on a block diagram of how the auditory system works. And it's very detailed, and there's lots of stuff going on, and there's some good guesses on what different parts of this are doing, a lot of it coming out of John Hopkins. But you'll notice that in both cases, most of the arrows are pointing in one way. So on this way, all the arrows are pointing one way. And on this way, most information flow is going up this way, although Lloyd was nice enough to include a couple of downward pointing arrows. And what I'd like to talk about, actually I want to play one more example. What I'd like to talk about is how us engineers like to build things bottom up. We like to start at the bottom and work up. And speech recognition people have been great about noticing and understanding the fact that language models make a big difference. But these top-down models need to be incorporated into the auditory physiology, and they need to be incorporated into the scene analysis stuff. I'm going to end with these two examples of the difficulty that we are facing when we think about the cocktail party effect. This first example is example showing tone and noise.
We present a tone alternating with a silence. Then the silence is replaced by a soft white noise. After each group of cycles, the noise is increased in intensity. In the final group, the spectrum level of the noise is the same as that of the tone. At this setting, the tone seems continuous behind the noise.
So what you should listen for is, when does the tone sound continuous?
So hopefully these speakers then aren't what I was expecting. Hopefully what you heard at the end was that the tone was continuous. You didn't hear the tone turning on and off again. And that's because the auditory system hears a tone and says, okay, I'll continue hearing the tone unless I hear something else going on. And that's what keeps you sane when you're listening to a cocktail party, in fact, because there's so much going on, you have to assume that things are going on continuously. That's sort of the old plus new model of perception. I want you to listen to a speech example now.
The state governors met with their respective legislatures convening in the capital city.
Okay, who can tell me in what word did the cough appear? Okay, have you heard this before? So if you haven't heard this before, I suspect you couldn't tell me when the cough occurred. And it's sort of a cheap demonstration of the of auditory streaming in a sense that you're hearing the speech, you're concentrating the speech, you're trying to hear what this person is saying, and the cough occurs, and it's a different speaker. It's coming from somewhere else. It's not part of the speech. You compartmentalize, you put it in a different channel. You can't even tell where it occurred. And so I think it's pretty dramatic. Here's the original audio.
The state governors met with their respective legislatures convening in the capital city.
So I suspect all of you heard the word legislature in the first example perfectly correctly. None of you heard it distorted in any way. And that wasn't what you heard. I mean, that's not what went to your ears. I'm sorry, you heard it correctly. And so trying to understand that process, I think, is a wonderful problem. And hopefully we'll have more progress on it this summer. So, thank you.